Your side. Okay.
Okay, I'll open the regular board meeting on Wednesday, March 9th, 2016, CCWD. Scott, can you lead us in the pledge allegiance?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Roll call.
Is Director Davidson?
Here.
Director Ratterman?
Here.
President Strange?
Here.
Director Mills?
Here.
And Director Underhill?
Here.
Good. Item two, public comment. At this time, members of the public may address the board on any non-agendized item. Public is encouraged to work through staff to place items on the agenda for board consideration. No action will be taken on matters not listed on the agenda, and comments are limited to 5 minutes per person. Do you have any public comment?
Hi, my name's Elaine St. John, and I live in the Lake Tomac area, and I just want to thank you all for putting the new intake valve in Tomac. It was such a relief that it was done, and a lot of times you don't hear anything great, but we're real happy about that, so I wanted to thank you so much, and obviously you brought it under budget, the original budget too. So thank you so much, and you're doing a great job.
Great, thank you.
Good morning. I just want to thank the organization for that trip to Washington, D.C. I really appreciate the lasting impression you left on those folks in Washington, D.C. I want to thank you very much, and I appreciate it.
Do you have a public comment? Seeing none, we'll go to item three, the consent agenda. Certain items are expected to be routine and non-controversial. Items will be acted upon by the board at one time without discussion. Any board member may request that any item be removed for later discussion. 3A, approval of minutes for the board meeting of February 17, 2016. 3B, review board of directors monthly timesheets for February 2016.
Move to accept.
Second.
So we've got a motion by Director Underhill and a second by Director Ratton. Can we take a vote?
Director Underhill?
Yes.
Director Mills?
Yes.
Director Ratton?
Yes.
Director Davidson?
Yes.
And President Strange?
Yes. Agenda item passes 5-0. Item number four, award of contract. 4A, award of contract for proposal to design services of the Jenny Lind Water Treatment Plant Pre-Treatment Facilities Project, CCWD CIP 11092, Charles Palmer.
Mr. President, before we go straight to that item, I'd just like to give a little something to one of our directors who has a special today, David. Director Underhill, I know it's your birthday, and
why did you just know?
Happy birthday.
Happy birthday. You'll have to be careful with the candle if you don't set off the sprinklers.
I'm feeling sure not to light it. So.
Thank you all.
Cool. Nice. Okay, Charles.
Okay, good morning. Well, I'm also a March birthday. Thanks for it. So the Jenny Lind project, that's a Jenny Lind Water Treatment Plant Pre-Treatment Project. It's being funded through Cal OSHA FEMA Hazard Mitigation Grant Program. So the first step that we've taken is to retain a consulting engineer to assist with the design of that project. And so just kind of a summary of what's going on with that project, why it was necessary. We have a condition of a deteriorating water quality in our raw water supply. in the aftermath of the Butte fire and the prior drought. And, you know, there's a high, that what that's causing is it's kind of causing, we've had problems in the past with turbidity in the water, but it's just making that situation worse. The, you know, the turbidity is seen mostly during storm events. And, you know, we also get higher organic loading, which is an issue because organics are, can be difficult to remove, especially when they dissolve in the water, being difficult to remove from the water. And they ultimately result in disinfection byproducts. We don't get enough sufficient removal of those organics out of the water. We have our ongoing manganese issues with the raw water. And, you know, so we've been, there's an issue with water age in the system. We have a pretty system that spreads out quite a bit, and, you know, we've been restricted on how much we can flush, so causes various problems. In some conditions, in these high storm events, we're unable to operate the plant. So some of those are some of the reasons why we're doing this project. And so our proposal process, January 14th, we issued a request for proposals and advertised in the newspaper. January 25th, we conducted a job walk with the prospective consulting firms. On February 12th, we received the proposals. On February 15th through the 29th, that was kind of when we were, and staff did their reviews, including Dave and Teresa Panaka and myself and Jesse Hampton. We all reviewed those and had a few meetings discussing the proposals. Really, our decision came down to the week of March 1st through 3rd when we made our final selection. We received three proposals, one from Castle Engineers, who's done a lot of work for the district in past decades, and they're still working in the area, so hopefully there'll be an opportunity for them to work for us in the future.
Weren't they the original design of that?
That's correct, yes. Mm-hmm. They designed the original 2 MGD plant and also the upgraded 5 MGD plant. So, and then Peterson Brustad also submitted a proposal, and also West Yost submitted a proposal. So those were the three proposals we received. And so just to kind of the rough evaluation process we went through is, you know, the proposals had different approaches to work. So one of them suggested a pilot study, which is, you know, if you're not quite sure if your water quality, how to treat your water quality and the technology is going to be effective, that's the guaranteed way to prove it out that you know your technology is gonna treat your system. There's, you know, the problem with that is it was only like a proposed two-week pilot, so, and it's hard to guarantee that you know, you're gonna be able to have representative conditions when you're running your pilots. So Peterson, Brustad, and Marcios did not propose pilot studies. There's also the cost consideration. You know, typically you like to see a cost between 5 and 10%. So Castle and Peterson Brustad were, and that's 5 to 10% of the overall project cost is normally what you kind of rule of thumb for engineering services. So West Yost was kind of pushing the upper limit of that range. And also, you know, we needed some specific items in the scope of services, so Castle and Peterson Brustad were able to provide those. West Yost, where the specific item was equipment pre-purchase. You know, we, to keep our project on schedule, we really need to procure the treatment equipment in advance of issuing a construction contract, because it's a very long lead item, long lead time item because of the manufacturing and delivery process. And then just kind of all firms submitted a statement of qualifications. So we evaluate, basically they're all qualified There were some variations in qualifications. I think West Shields happened to have a somebody with a very, very, very high level of expertise, but I didn't think it was necessary to have that individual on the project necessarily. So, in general, all firms were qualified to perform the work.
Before you leave that one, if you could go back to that slide real quick, and just to know, you know, that difference in price, there is a difference between, you know, those two, all, obviously all three, but we're looking, and we're not, the recommendation is a proposal that is a little bit higher than the Castle proposal, Peters and Brewstad. But we feel like that what was proposed by Castle, doing the pilot testing of these different types of systems, could actually lead to a more expensive project, because we would have to refund our plant to be able to do this. There's quite a bit of work that would have to be done just to be able to install this equipment to be able to use it. So that would be additional cost, either having someone do that or having to do it ourselves. And then as well, we'd have to get a permit from the Drinking Water Division of the State Water Board to be able to do that. It would be time and cost associated with that. And the main problem with all of this is, given the importance of getting this project done as soon as we can, that would probably lead to a pretty significant delay that really could make it not possible for us to get the construction done in the period that we want to.
The question that I would have was, is the yearly operational costs and maintenance going to be calculated into this design so that we know we're looking at something that is going to be efficient in the longer term rather than looking at a solution that is going to lead to other issues down the road?
There's a number of factors like that, and that's another, I'm glad you brought up that point, that's another consideration. Obviously, there's a difference between potential difference between energy costs, a lot of, you know, the pumping costs are a big part of that, the O&M costs there. I mean, we've already got the operators on site, but yeah, I mean, there's also other issues like how much waste backwash, why you have to backwash all these systems, or they have side streams of not the main process water, but they all generate side streams of that could impact our ability to operate the plant effectively. That's a good point, you know, something to add to our conversation with the consultant. We're going to have a kickoff meeting later this week, as soon as we approve this contract.
My concern is that we don't buy the wrong car on pace, that we do think through what is the 5-year, 10-year, 20-year cost of this, and are we going to have to come in, say, 10 years from now and do something very different simply because we made this decision today, or did we think that through in the overall?
Right, yeah, we don't want to have, obviously at some point we're going to have to increase our capacity there, so we want something that's going to fit into that scenario.
And Director Mills, this is exactly what we're trying to do. We've implemented a team approach on everything from the even moving the concept to the RFP to working with the design engineering. Everything is going to involve a multidisciplinary team that's going to include operations. We've even got operators, staff that are here as part of the team to talk about what is it going to mean, ongoing obligations to and needs and all those kind of things going forward. So we don't have any surprises when we come out of this.
So this one, whatever we design and build there, will accommodate the existing customers. But is there, are we going to figure out the proportionality of future customers? And is there going to be a capacity fee component of this cost?
I don't think so. I mean, this project has all been about preserving the functionality of the plant as it exists today. Any customer, this could be important to us. Obviously, we hope it and expect it will in years into the future, even in time we would have additional customers. But it really is, and that's why we asked for the board to add this to the R&R list, because it's really about being able to operate the facilities that are there today. That weren't put in place with the idea that we would have the effects of a fire like this.
The other question I have is, I've been driving that road quite a bit just to look at the river and lake level and everything. Obviously, it is pretty rotten looking stuff. Are we going to do any is there going to be any testing, lake testing of what's actually in that water and to make sure?
It's already been in process. Jesse Hampton with our own department has collected samples. We've had several phone calls back and forth and we've been taking samples.
The other concern I have, it's not directly related, but I'm bringing it up anyway, people have because it's a water source, many people in the area, and this is the area, think that we have some authority over the lake, and obviously we don't, but I am curious if there is going to be some water quality testing on the lake, and if nothing else, if we can inquire about that information and share it, because it's probably the most used recreational lake in the county. When it gets to that low pool, there's leeches and all sorts of things that come up, and people claim to be getting sick and could happen. I don't know. But is there an entity that tests the water for public safety? And is there a danger of it not being safe to swim in this year? I know that's not our, it's not up to us, but I just wonder who does that sort of thing? And can we inquire about that?
A little off topic here.
Well, we can certainly take that as a recommendation and look into it. I know that we have consumer confidence reports for our water plant that tell us that the water is safe to drink, but it's been treated, obviously. So, and obviously there's impacts from the fire that we are uncertain of. So, it's certainly a question that we could inquire about.
I would appreciate if you did.
Department of Public Health.
I have a couple of questions. Jenny Lynn is we've heard Jenny Lynn for a long time, and bring me up to date. Did I not just read something about Jenny Lynn operations being halted or?
Well, this has happened in the past when we get really high turbidity levels in stream. Our system is not designed to deal with those very high turbidity levels, and normally what happens they try to operate the filters the best they can. They have a lot of things they can do with flexibility in the way they operate the filters to try to keep them running as long as they can during when we're talking about a very brief period, maybe a day or hours, 8 hour period. And there's ways they can, in this particular winter, they have been topping off our tanks to make sure that our treated water tanks are fully full to their maximum levels before these storm events, in anticipation of these storm events. So we have some little contingency time there to a day or so where we can shut down our system without really causing any concern to the public.
And so through that, all that process is where we heard FEMA, right? Did we hear?
Well, that's why, that's what Bill Burley worked on and was really, got out there as quickly as possible. I think this was the first FEMA award of the grant related to the Butte Fire. And it's just recognition of the fact that, we've experienced that. We know that particularly with low water levels in the reservoir, there are issues, particularly when there are sizable releases downstream for other users downstream. We've had some issues trying to deal with the water quality coming in, but not on this scale with a fire like this. And we can see the effects of it right now. And the reality is this is going to be going on for years to come. But so we really wanted to be proactive with that and make sure that we could again protect the functionality of the plant. We're trying to be as I really give a ton of credit to our staff and our operators in particular that they're being proactive and totally what this project is about. So again, we don't want to create fear or anything like that. We're obviously providing safe, reliable supply of water for the customers down there. Will continue to be our absolute highest priority, and we'll do that. But again, we just need to be, it's the prudent thing to do. It's the responsible thing to do is to implement this project. And, fortunately, FEMA agreed and provided that funding for it.
Okay. Yeah, I wanted to mention that we all know the name Peterson and Brewster. They have quite a history with CCWD as far as our jobs are concerned. They've been around for years. And so I thought that was a rather outstanding RFP. And they gave us a reference list that was unmatched. I mean, nobody, did anybody else give us that kind of, you know, the number of jobs that they have done?
I think that was, you know, they, I'm sure the other consultants could put together an equal resume of projects. But, you know, like I said, I think all the consultants were qualified to do the work, easily qualified.
Because it had some, you know, Amador and Tuolumne, so it was, made us feel like part of the...
Right, and they did do the plan upgrade for when we went to 6MGE, when we added the filter. They did a great job on that. And they do have 18 as their sub, who 18 pretty much does all our electrical work. So it's going to be very simple for 18 to jump onto this project. They already have a head start even before they do anything.
You initially asked or presented a budget of $250,000, and so now we're going to have to up it. Would there be a problem in asking?
I want to maybe have us consider holding some of the comments back until the presentation's been done, so that it might be able to be more timely. My only comment, if you could go back, is that we're not just...
The proposal's not done.
Thank you. Let me see on task though here. I'm concerned about the water quality in that, no. In looking at the fact that the low bid didn't receive the award, is that going to create any problems with OES or FEMA?
No, not at all. This is in a professional services agreement like this, particularly with an engineering design. It's not the same as a construction contract. Price is an important factor, but it's not the only factor. It's really the best overall solution, the best value of the district. So that's again, that's why, you know, we spend a lot of time on the references, the other experience, the approach to the project, all of that to come up with the recommendations.
Okay, great, thanks. Go ahead, Charles. Sorry.
Yeah, so I was just trying to have a few conclusions here. You know, basically, I think they've kind of touched on why the pilot was not really, you know, we considered it and thought it was a good idea. You know, we were concerned about the short duration of it only being a couple weeks. Really, could we get representative data out of that short of a pilot? There, it added some complexity for operation time and complexity for CCWD staff, as well as we did contact the Division of Drinking Water, and they wanted us to write up a work plan and submit that for their approval. So it was going to, above and beyond what Castle had proposed, it was going to take us some effort on CCWD's part to make those pilot studies work. You know, we've got electrical connections, piping connections that our construction crew and electricians were going to have to participate in. So that really made it a little bit, a little concerns as to whether we could pull that all off and pull resources away from other businesses that are taking care of. With West Yost, again, you know, they didn't have this. They were kind of pushing my comfort zone as far as what is a feasible, reasonable fee. And, you know, and they weren't including this equipment pre-purchase, which I felt was a necessary element. So that was the reason we didn't select their proposal. Peterson Brewstad, again, I think they provided a proposal that met all our requirements. It wasn't contingent on a pilot study, and they included this equipment pre-purchase effort, and they have the qualifications and experience necessary for the project. So anyway, I was just kind of repeating what the recommendation is. So we're recommending that the board approve the award of that contract and authorize the general manager to execute the professional services agreement with Peterson Brewstad in the amount of $311,840 for the engineering and design services for the genuine water treatment plant project.
So moved.
Second.
Okay, how about some discussion? Bertha, I didn't really mean to cut you off, but I did, so.
Yeah, I know.
Well, so now's the time. I just wanted to make sure that his presentation was full, so.
Did,
You answered everything. I just was commenting on the fact that, you know, I thought the Peterson proposal was right on, and it answered all our questions, and.
They did, one thing that they did better than the others is they seemed to really emphasize the importance of the schedule and trying to meet our preferred deadline of having the system up and running by the end of the year, so.
What does this current weather do to them?
That has, you know, we're not going to be able to have anything up and running this winter. You know, so it's going to be by, we're hoping by the next winter that this system will be up and running.
But we will be all right.
Yes, yeah. I mean, so far the plant staff have been able to contend with all the issues that they've approached, faced with the raw water quality issues.
Didn't see any comments?
No, thank you.
Scott?
Thanks. I have one more thing. I think that this winter obviously is going to be a good test because we are going to get some high flows. We will get some high flows and some certainly high turbidity. You know, again, I think this is important. I think it's really important that and maybe you should alert the board as we get some of this water testing in as to the differences of the water quality now as in previous years. You know, I know we have some high water years and we can probably go back and I'm sure I assume we test the intake material, but I'm just curious to know what the difference, you know, what different elements and such are in that water. And I just want to, you know, I'll be asking the same question when we design this facility that we built one that's going to actually handle any differences in the water quality.
Okay.
I have a few comments. One is that it doesn't look like anybody really met our desirable operational by January schedule. So it looks like that's, and I don't know if the other bids, I haven't seen the other bids and whether the higher price meant that they came, you know, but like I say, by the end of the year, it looked like Bruce did. They had two different examples or situations. One, the earliest was the end of January, which is close. The other, I think, was out into the spring as far as operational, so.
I think, President Church, I think our goal is to have substantial completion done as quickly as possible, and ideally we would have it done coming into the next wet season. So that's what we're gonna be pushing for. I mean, final completion of the project, and all of the closeout documentation, and then we'll be into next year. But we wanna make sure that our target we're working for is to get this new equipment in operation so we realize the benefit of it as we come into the next wet season.
Okay.
And I think I think this proposal gives us the best opportunity to make that happen.
And then the other comments was that they mentioned that there's no environmental permitting included cost wise on that. Is that something that you feel we can do in-house? Obviously, the Native American issues out there are the biggest.
It was already reviewed by FEMA, and maybe we need to clarify with them or go back to them and revisit the issue of the cultural resources. I think we're going to have to do some consultation with the tribe and bring in there.
Sure.
You know, just to cover our bases there. It's you know, they even have some caveats in our agreement that, you know, if we don't properly address those issues, they will stop our project until we do so. Yeah. There's no sense postponing that process.
But as far as other CEQA requirements beyond cultural,
on the NEPA side, I believe I'm not as certain about CEQA, but on NEPA, I believe that this is under exemption given the emergency declaration that people was able to operate under. I don't know what. You know, what category we're going under CEQA, but it's my understanding, other than, you know, the tribal resource issues, which we've been working with the tribe with to come up with this, strategy to deal with that. Other than that, I don't think there's anything substantial that I'm aware of.
As long as we stay out of the riparian zone, and there's...
Yeah, I mean, it's within the existing plan, so that's part of it. I mean, this is area that's already been constructed under, so.
Yeah. And then the last thing they talk about in project assumptions, the scope of services are for the project recommended in 2008. report. Are you familiar? I assume you're familiar. You've read the 2008 report. I mean,
I was there when that was done. Yes, I haven't read it, to be honest, since 2008. It was a study about the manganese issues there and removing manganese. So I think that was given the time frame we had to submit our FEMA application. I think that was the thing that was closest to our needs there. So I think that's why in our new scope for the engineering design services, we're going to be evaluating those technologies, making sure that that's the appropriate selection. So we're not going to just run with that and jump right into design. Right. We're going to take the time to evaluate the technologies and make sure we get that process correct. We also want to bring in our operators, recognize their challenges and difficulties, and they have a great understanding of the water that they're treating. They treat it every day. They know better than anybody their challenges. So, we want to involve them in that process so that they can, maybe they have insights that as engineers we don't necessarily have. So, because they have to treat the water every day.
But then, then just after that, they talk about that there may be a need to change the scope and fees for the project if the assumptions aren't quite met. To me, that's a lot of wiggle room for change orders and stuff and cost increases and all. But I mean, how comfortable or confident are you that that's?
I feel that they've got the fee is appropriate. They, as long as we don't make mistakes in the process and we don't totally reverse direction halfway through the process, that I think that fee should be fine.
And just Director Strange, the President Strange, that's exactly why we went back the recommendation of the team and Charles, that we go back and we did a really complete RFP. We wanted to do that so that we could get that more. I mean, there's certain, given the fact that we don't know exactly what technology we're going to choose, but to be clear, we are still going to evaluate other options, and there will be, we can look to what's in operation elsewhere to be able to look at how it functions, but that's why we don't have exactly, this is exactly the project that you have designed. So, but I do feel like we're in a much better place now having gone through the RFP than we were before that, where, we were relying on that 2008 report, and, there was a sense of what project needed to be done, but I think we're in a better place right now to get it done and stay within
Yeah, these contracts are time and material. So, if we give them direction, it doesn't really matter if the scope changes that much, as long as it's all based on they bill us for their hours worked and, time travel. Yeah. That kind of thing.
Okay.
One last thing. Change orders, is it still, what is it these days?
Our general attitude is, we don't favor change orders. Certainly we want to stay within budget and scope. To be clear though, it's not, there are times occasionally when it is actually, beneficial to the agency to have access to change orders, to be able to better hone in your project. It's not just the price, there can be other considerations. That's why, they're not always going to be that way, but like on the Lift Station 22 project, we were able to come in with a change order of about 1% of the total original bid price, and that was pretty impressive. Again, that's not always going to be the case, but that's our mindset, is we want to try to keep that to a minimum. Again, there are certain considerations on this project that again, we got to evaluate these technologies. And,
because depending upon the price of the project determines what a percentage of change orders are permissible, right?
Yeah, Charles, I don't know what the industry norm is on change orders. It's to be expected that you're more so on the construction side than this. There are many things that you have to deal with in the field that aren't exactly as you anticipated when you went out to bid. That's just the reality of it. We should do a whole presentation on change orders. It's exactly what we need to have. Inspections, project management, all of that lined up. And it's really important. I really firmly believe that we need the team in house to be able to do that. with that full accountability, because that's how you really try to effectively manage that project budget to keep those change orders down and to hire really qualified firms.
Right, because I remember one of the worst change order things happened up in your district.
Oh, now wait. Yeah, no, it's
the rock.
You know, the contractor stands for a lot of money in change order manipulations.
Believe it, we live with rock colossus. But change orders are good in that, in one way, in that the contractor has an opportunity to come to you, and if there's good communication going back and forth, they may be able to propose ideas and change in those changes that will save money and will also be more efficient in how it works. So I'm not negative to change orders in any way, shape, or form, because it does show how the communication stream is working.
Yeah, deductive change orders are always a very pleasant thing. So the name change order itself shouldn't be seen as a derogatory thing.
Okay, thank you, Charles.
Thank you.
We'll open it up to public comment.
I have a good question. Is anybody on the board or any of the staff any prior experience with this company?
Oh, that's what I said, yes.
They did? Mm-hmm. Okay. Thank you.
Yeah, that's one of the real advantages is this firm has first-hand experience on upgrades to this exact plan, so they know it inside and out.
And also in some of the meetings that we go to travel, we get to meet the principals of many of these different firms, and you get a feel for just talking with them and kind of folks they are. And with the two principals of Peterson Brustad, they're very much down to earth folks. They appear very conscientious, want to do a good job. They're in it for the long term. And I feel very comfortable with it. Any other public comment? No? Okay. Can we take the vote?
Director Henderson?
Yes.
Director Mills?
Yes.
Director Ratterman?
Yes.
Director Davidson?
Yes.
And President Jenkins?
Yes. So the resolution number?
2016-10.
So we have a motion then in approval to adopt resolution 2016-10, approving consultant selection and award, and authorizing the general manager to execute a professional services agreement with Peterson Brustad, Inc., in the amount of $310,840 for engineering and design services for the Jenny Lind Water Treatment Plant Pretreatment Project, CCWD 11092. Cal OES FEMA Hazard Mitigation Grant FEMA-4240-DR-CA. Cool. Okay. Get back to the agenda. Item number 5A, new business. Discussion action regarding nomination of board member for consideration to fill independent special district seat on the Calaveras LAFCO Commission.
Mr. President, members of the board, this item is to actually request the board take action to, by minute of entry here at the meeting today, to make a nomination to one of the seats for the independent special district seats on the local agency formation commission for the Calaveras County. They gave us notice sometime recently, when I informed the board at the last meeting. We received this notice that there was a call for nominations for two regular seats and one alternate seat. So this nomination would be for one of those seats, ideally one of the regular seats, but the alternate seat. And at the last meeting, I asked that if any board member had any interest in being considered for nomination, please provide that to our board clerk. With that, we got Director Ratterman, who was the only board member who did express interest in being considered for nomination. And so what's recommended for you today is to take action to make that nomination, and we will communicate that to LAFCO. And this would be for the four-year seat.
Okay, I'd like to make a motion to nominate Director Radden for the LAFCO Board of Directors.
Second.
Okay, you have a second. Do we go to public comment on this? Okay, public comment. case you have no enemies.
I had one point to make here. Lynn Lapco, please understand that it's going to require a vote from each one of the three entities to be appointed to the board in any manner that comes before it. So that is the only piece that it seems to be a stumbling block from time to time, is getting a single vote from each one of the three entities to be appointed.
And the three entities.
Sure. Three entities are the City of Angels Camp, the Independent Districts, and the Calaveras County Board. So, thank you.
Well, the difficulty in getting somebody seated on this is every special district board votes on this, right?
No, only the LAFCO members that are currently assigned to LAFCO from Independent District.
Is that the case? I believe each independent district will vote on this.
I'm sorry, at the top of my head, I don't have the answer to that. Mona, do you have any information on that?
I have the information.
Okay, we'll check into that.
It's immaterial to the nomination, but the way I believe this works is that all the special districts will have a list of candidates and they'll vote on which of the candidates they want. It's been difficult to pass for us to get somebody on the LAFCO board, even though we pay the lion's share of their cost.
We do. I think you're right on the open member.
The open member.
The special district members, which are two seats.
Gotcha.
If that is the case, though, could we please get a report back on that?
So yeah, I'd like to find out there too. That I understood it to be what the Director Davidson is indicating, that the special district each special district, fire districts, cemetery districts, water districts, have an opportunity to for their representative, their special district representative on LAFCO.
Plus, you have an at-large member, which is in the PAC right now.
I think that there's a couple, and that's what's going on. What's been going on the last two or three months, and the voting is for the open seat, for just at large. Members of the public.
The voting is actually, it's described in the last paragraph of the communication segment from the LAFCO that's attached to the materials. And it says, upon conclusion of this nomination process, a ballot to elect the LAFCO representatives will be mailed to each independent special district. Each independent special district board will have one vote. Right. Nominees receiving the highest number of votes will be seated as an independent special district regular member representative for this term, and the nominee receiving the third highest votes will be appointed the independent special district host.
So that is to your point, Director Newman.
Scott, you have been attending LAFCO on behalf or as a representative of CCWD?
I have in the past. I attended every one of the meetings, no.
Well, not every one.
Yeah, I've attended meetings in the past.
Yes. Uh-huh.
Okay. Actually, I should probably go back out to public comment now since I messed that up a little bit, but that won't be the last time I do something like that. Seeing no public comment, can we take a vote then?
Director
Underhill?
Yes.
Director Mills?
Yes.
Director
Radman?
Yes.
Director Davidson?
Yes.
And President Hinch? Yes. Okay, good. So by a 5-0 vote, we nominate Mr. Radman for the LAFCO Board of Directors. Good. Item number 5B, discussion regarding calling a general district election. Okay.
Yes, Mr. President, members of the board, this is just to meet the requirement to actually adopt a resolution calling for a consolidation of our election for the two seats that are open this fall, with the general election on November 8th. Again, the advantage of that, the reason we've gone through this and the board made that decision in the past, was to avoid the necessity of having a special elections or an election on the odd years when there's not a general election that requires us to pay more in the way of expenses because there's not as many others to share that cost. So with this resolution, it would be to ask that the county that we be able to consolidate and to also commit to providing reimbursement for our costs. And we don't have those exact figures yet. The registered voters will provide that to us later, but again, we budgeted for that and we expect that to be significant cost savings from what we had to do in the past when we're able to consolidate.
Good. Perfect.
Yes. The last time we did this, we asked, do you remember, we asked how much money we were able to save, and they had an accumulator that they had in county. Did we ever find out?
Yes, it was approximately $10,500 for the four divisions of recollection in 2014.
$10,000? That we saved.
No, that was
total. How much it cost? Mm-hmm. Okay.
Saved, I don't know, because that was part of the sense of the general election, but we probably saved at least 10 to 15.
Seems like our election right there has to cost in the neighborhood of 30,000,
40,000.
But we were doing all mail. The last time I ran was an all mail in ballot. That was the first crack at saving money. So I don't know how it changed after that.
So through this process, we definitely have the opportunity to save some significant money because of the district.
Move for acceptance of 5B.
I second.
Okay, so we've got Director Adams' motion, seconded by Director Mills. A public comment? Seeing none, we take a vote.
Director Mills?
Yes.
Director Mills?
Yes.
Director Radiman?
Yes.
Director Davidson?
Yes.
And President Strange?
Yes. So resolution number, and I'm looking for the last one, I just 11. So resolution number 2016-11 approving the consolidation of the district election with the general district election. Will be held on November 8th, 2016. Passes 5-0. Okay. New business item 5C, discussion action regarding formation of CCWD's public financing joint powers authority.
Good morning, Mr. President, members of the board. The item before you is regarding the creation of a public financing authority with two resolutions. At this time, if you pause for about a minute, I'd like to conference call and Cameron Weist, our bond counsel, who will assist in this presentation and answer any of your questions.
Just really smiling.
Are we ready, Mr. President?
Yes, go ahead.
Thank you. The reason Cameron is joining us by conference call is that he does have a presentation later on in the day. I believe it's in Lakeport. So traveling, it just didn't make logical sense for him to come here first and then have to travel all the way up there and for two presentations in the same day. Cameron has been our bond counsel for a number of years and has been involved in a number of financing, refinancing, assessment districts. So he's very familiar with our district and we are familiar with him. And one of the things we have tasked him to do is to work on this USDA loan grant package that we will be receiving for the REACH 3A project. As you're aware, we're moving along and we've got bids in and we're getting ready to go through that process of awarding the bid. However, what we need to do is finish up our financing package, excuse me, first before USDA will allow us to award the bid. Now, USDA generally requires you to have a loan grant component. Very rarely do they do just a grant. It's a loan grant component. And we have received a loan grant component for this REACH 3A project. The loan would be $2,622,000, and the grant component is $1,378,000. To complete the loan process, USDA requires the district to issue a security. That means we have to use a third party. They just don't go out and loan us the money. It's a little bit different when we're dealing with other agencies. The federal government has a little bit different rules, requirements. So we generally would look at working with a nonprofit, a 501c3, to be able to be that third party to facilitate, because we as a district do not have the authorization to go out and issue debt directly for this process. So we go through, partner up with a nonprofit corporation. This is a one-off time. You pick up a corporation, you work with them, they charge you, and you have a partnership with them for the life of the loan. Doing this requires us to obviously get a public corporation, a public entity to be able to work with. These are becoming fewer and far in between that these public entities, nonprofits want to do this process. So in the state of California, the Constitution allows the creation of some agencies to be able to act in that manner to create a relationship. CCWD would create a relationship with that agency in the form of a joint powers authority. Then we'd be able to create what we have as our own public financing authority. This is done in numerous areas. When I was with the city of Folsom, we had a public financing authority that could go out and issue the debt necessary. So we're looking at a long-term solution to not only take care of the short-term loan issue that we have with USDA, but also when we're looking at future issues. We are going to be going out with USDA and trying to get another loan grant component for the REACH 1 process. And so we would have to use a mechanism to finance through a nonprofit for that. Those nonprofits charge about $5,000 a shot. Looking at this particular process of creating a JPA with an agency, and then the legal costs associated with it, the one we're looking at, is about $15,000. So within three times, it would basically pay for itself, but would also give us our flexibility when we go out in the future, because there will be times when this district will have to issue long-term bonds to pay for long-term, the replacement of long-term assets. And this will allow us to be able to issue that without having to go out again with a third party. And so that it's kind of a multi-dimensional approach. It's a new concept for us, I understand, and that's the reason why Cameron is here, to help explain it. But what we're looking at doing here today is to pass two resolutions. The first resolution is to form a JPA between Calaveras County Water District and the Independent Cities Finance Authority. These are local agencies that we've formed together, a JPA. Then the next resolution would be actually creating a Calaveras County Water District Public Financing Authority. That would be your board, basically. You would be the board members of the Public Financing Authority. You would have the ability to vote on issuing debt. The debt that we're looking at issuing would come from the Public Financing Authority, and it would be backed by certain revenues. We have the ability to issue revenue bonds, which save us in the long term because they're a little bit more creditworthy than certificates of participation and other debt instruments. So those are the two mechanisms. Now, we looked at different agencies to work with. One, we were going to work with California Financing Authority. They backed out at the last minute and said they're no longer going to be doing any financing options. Then we looked at two other organizations. We looked at the, like I said, the Independent Cities Finance Authority, ICFA, and then we also looked at CSCDA, which is the California Statewide Communities Development Authority. And we're looking at the ability to do business with them long term. We are looking at the ease of doing business with them. Basically, which is administratively, which district or which agency is easiest to work with that can facilitate our needs? That, because these agencies work with bond counsel as well. They have their own counsel that reviews these deals. I believe CDA is Orrick Harrington, and ICFA is BB. Cameron, help me out there.
Yes, Best and Krieger.
That's right, Best and Krieger. Two reputable firms, very reputable firms. So in looking at this, one of the things is the ability of the different or agencies to help us out to facilitate the issuance of debt, the requirements of both, the requirements of their counsel, and the cost. When we compare costs, ICFA was $15,000 initial cost. That includes their administrative fee and legal costs, including Cameron's costs, to set this up. When we're looking at CSCDA, it was $20,000 in one-time costs. So a little bit more expensive. So in looking at that and understanding the background and the ability to meet our needs, we're recommending ICFA, the Independent Cities Finance Authority. And Cameron, can you step in here and give them a little bit more information on what a public financing authority does and the requirement of having a JPA as our acting as a third party?
Certainly, yes. As you all know, I've been in the business, for 25 plus years now, and I can tell you that especially in the last 15 years, more so even in the last 5 years, as more and more laws come about that cut into public agency's ability to issue debt, it's been an evolution toward these public financing authorities that has taken front and center stage for government agencies in California. And the reason for that is really just an abnormality, in my opinion, in the public perception of public debt. And I'll explain that. There's what's called certificates of participation that cities issue that are backed by general fund debt, because the California Constitution does not allow cities to incur debt beyond 1 year without votes, GO bond votes of people. So public investors in these bonds have become jaded to COPs, and they're charging. I've dealt with many government agencies where we've had underwriters, Wall Street bankers, try to estimate the risk rate associated with COPs, and it always turns out it's between 20 basis points, almost a quarter of 1%, all the way up to a half a percent. So you can imagine if you're issuing, anything over a couple million dollars for more than 10 or 15 years, that differential at a quarter to a half a percent rate turns into a lot of money. same underlying credit stream, credit quality. So in other words, the revenue pledge could be the identical revenue pledge, but because you called one a certificate of participation versus a revenue bond, you're going to be dinged in the public marketplace to the extent that I just talked about. So what we've been, you know, recommending or possible is to try to get in a position to be able to issue revenue bonds as the nameplate of your financing vehicle. It just and that's just one of the reasons. That is a, you know, that's a financial, a fiscal reason, but there are several others. Predominantly, I think if you just look at it, if I could sum it up as a whole, you would say that the Joint Powers Act is more comprehensive than any other statutory body of law that's out there and available to any kind of district, whether it's any kind of public agency, whether it's a special district, a water agency, a city, a county, or what have you. It's just a more flexible body of law, allows you to do more things, which, we don't really want to speculate on what that could be for Calgary's County Water District, but suffice to say, there are some opportunities possibly in the future where you could utilize these powers and, and assist in your project financing down the road. But, Jeff, I think I hit the highlight of one of the main reasons, which is the financial reason. I did, cover the overall spectrum of, this global opportunity for more flexibility. But the real key here is that if you do pass the resolution and agree to partner up with another agency, I've spoken with all these agencies, and I've actually formed several of these districts now, these Joint Powers agencies, with cities or special districts, with these statewide financing authorities. And what I've demanded each and every step is that they allow you as the board of directors to dictate and operate your Joint Powers Authority unto yourselves and into yourselves. So you don't have to answer. There's no tentacles attached back to that other participating agencies. And in the Joint Powers Agreement, it clearly sets forth that the debt and liabilities, responsibilities are independent of one another. There's no cross-exposure. And there's no future ongoing cost that they're going to be able to extract from CCWD if you choose to go this direction. It's a one-time fee, and as I said, the liability is cut off at the time of entering into this joint powers agreement if you choose to go that direction.
Cameron, there's a question.
The length of time of the JPA, is there an expiration date, a sunset clause, as far as how long the JPA would be?
The Joint Powers Agreement, right, the way it reads right now, it allows you to go in perpetuity until terminated by both parties, or if and it cannot be terminated if there's debt outstanding. So, to the extent that you ever issue an obligation through the Joint Powers Authority, you would not be able to terminate it until the expiration of the debt. But because your board is the voting board, the sole voting board, you would have complete control as to when this authority would be terminated.
Okay, thanks. And the other question I had, I think you've already answered. There is no ongoing or additional administrative costs in future years.
That's correct. Yes.
Okay.
The question about, go ahead.
Oh, okay. I want to know that, it says the meetings of the JPA will be coordinated with regular board meetings of the district to avoid any inconvenience to board members in having to attend additional meetings. What will be our learning curve as far as being a member now of this JPA?
That's something that I was just going to ask Cameron to, as part of this presentation, to explain what the duties of the public financing authority are, and also the responsibilities, how often you meet. Now, and Cameron, please correct me if I'm wrong. The public financing authority will meet on the same days as the board of directors. it will be part of your agenda. If, and you will open up the Public Financing Authority at each meeting, if there's no business, you close it, and that's the end of the action for that particular day. Is that correct, Cameron?
Let me just, a minor correction on the deal. The way we wrote this is even a little bit more simpler than that, is that it is going to, it automatically, if there is business, and the board clerk sets the agenda with business as to the authority will be open for business that regular meeting. If there is no business, it, there's no need to open it, it automatically cancels, okay, pursuant to the terms of the agreement.
Does it have to be noticed in the agenda as no business?
No.
Okay,
no.
Then.
And so my question is, Dennis and I sit on the finance committee right now, so that will that knowledge of what goes on in the finance committee be similar to what goes on if we have business for this?
Absolutely. Yeah, the key here is, you have to think of it is really it's the board of directors. It's you're wearing different hats at the time of the board, at the time of the joint powers authority meeting. But for purposes of the finance committee meeting, I mean, I'm Jeff, please correct me if I'm wrong, but I mean, this public financing authority is at your disposal. There, even though you had to have another member to form this, there's no participation whatsoever from the other agency. So it really becomes, if there's a financial matter that affects the district, this is just a mechanism that gives you some financial flexibility with how you would solve that financial dilemma. But it does not affect the way the finance committee runs or operates. It's just a tool in the toolbox to be able to discuss and utilize. If you decide to utilize it, of course, the board just simply wears a different hat and adopts resolutions that are of that authority. But really, that's the only effect.
Okay, so then you, Cameron, are going to be the driving factor.
Well, I wouldn't say that, Ms. Hunter, I would say that I am just your counsel from time to time for bond transactions, and really I would love to be able to help in any way. And, you know, I think I've exhibited, you know, my willingness to do that without charging, so I'm there. If you ever have questions, of course I'll be there, but I'm not really the driving factor. I'm setting this up, and then it's yours to take and do what you want. It's just a method. It's a tool to be able to utilize in the future as your finance director, you know, starts to understand and want to utilize this. Of course, it'll get brought to the finance committee. We'll discuss it, and then if it's something that rises to the level of need for counsel, I would be there. But I'll be there anyway to answer questions if you ever have them.
Just being able to explain what the situations are where that we would actually meet. It's not just an annual thing. If there was another loan opportunity came up or a reason, then we would obviously meet and have to take a vote. What other circumstances? If it was we were going to prepay it off, or what are the other situations where we would meet?
Did you hear the question, Cameron?
You know what, I didn't catch all that. I'm so sorry. The phone was not just great quality. I mean, it's good, but I just didn't catch all that.
I apologize, Cameron. It's Jeff Davidson. No, I was just saying maybe you could explain to the board what scenarios where we would meet on an unscheduled basis would be, whether refinancing, is it coming up with if another loan opportunity comes around? What are the scenarios other than just the annual review or whatever we would do on a normal basis?
Well, I mean, you wouldn't have any, if you ever had the need for a special meeting, you know, of course that could be called, just like it could be called for your board of directors, but you can only approve bond financings at regular meetings, and that's why the document be coordinated to make sure that you don't have to think about that in the future. But as far as the financial, the financial opportunities with Joint Powers Authority are really, you know, they're really similar to what the district has and has explored and will continue to explore in the future. It really just allows you the counterparty ability to have another entity at your disposal made debt, for example, you thankfully go up to 10, 12, 15 years. If you ever want to go out past that amount of time, you have to go out to a public offering. You really, it's your only choice to go beyond 12 to 15 years. So to do that, you have to have a counterparty. And the only way to issue revenue bonds, we started out this conversation, is through a joint powers agency under the Mark Shrews Powers, the Joint Powers Act that we're talking about here today. That, and otherwise, you have to issue certificates of participation that an underwriter can sell on a basis of greater than 15 years, and you're going to get charged that risk premium that I talked about. And that is an expensive proposition when you're talking about a good amount of debt over a longer period of time. So, again, the financial flexibilities are that it gives you another agency to be more fiscally sound, to have a better chance to be able to save money for the district in terms of lower interest rates. It gives you, if I were to go down the list of powers of the Joint Powers Agency, you would see they can do pretty much anything. It can do anything. It can do water, wastewater, fire. I mean, I know you don't need all those powers, but it certainly is an opportunity in the state of California that so many agencies are utilizing because they're finding creative ways. I mean, there's all kinds of new laws that are coming about all the time, environmental laws, that are financing opportunities. For example, you've probably heard about the PACE program, the housing, there's where the government has said, you have to do that through a joint powers authority. And I'm sure in the future there's going to be water measures, now that the drought's in place, where there's going to be grant loan programs and so forth, where, again, it's going to help you to have that counterparty to assist in getting those programs funded. Like I said, the projection of the future right now is not the easiest thing to do, but suffice to say, they're very flexible in their powers and what they can accomplish.
Cameron, can I follow up on that for just a moment? And I think I can clarify, too, is that the Public Finance Authority doesn't need to meet unless there's business on the table, which could include discussion and direction. Let's say the Finance Committee says, you know what, we want to go out and issue a 30-year bond because we're replacing significant pipeline that matches up to the life of the asset. So we're going to do that. Then they can bring it to the Public Financing Authority for discussion and direction. You're not actually issuing debt at that time, but you can have amongst yourselves the Public Financing Authority that says, yes, staff, go forward and find the best possible deal forward. Then at some point in the future, when we're ready to go through the issuing of the debt, then you would meet again. Am I correct in that, Cameron?
Absolutely. It is your board. It is an alter ego of the board of directors. So I guess that's where the most flexibility comes from.
The board of supervisors have all sorts of these joint powers that they meet. They meet on the same day. They close their meeting. They open a meeting of whatever senior agency or something like that. It's the same body. It's just a different title.
Yes.
And I think maybe one of the things that would help the board in making this decision is to recognize the cost of financing these COPs. I mean, we've had some incredible, albeit 20 years ago, COP, the upfront costs on those, and they've definitely been reduced in recent years under Jeff, but it seems like we've paid, $35,000 to establish some COPs, and hundreds of thousands of dollars years and years back. But, it seems like a significant cost saving opportunity as opposed to financing it through some of these other avenues, I'd say. I mean, maybe you could shed some light on what we have paid on some of for COPs and such.
I wasn't here when the district issued the COPs, but what you're looking at through, at least with the USDA here, is if any time you do the loan grant component, it's going to cost you at least $5,000 to work with a nonprofit, plus any of the additional fees, the legal fees that go on for review, Cameron's time, and anybody at bond counsel, and any other fees. What we're eliminating now moving forward is that $5,000 that you're paying to a nonprofit to administer. Then you're actually joined at the hip with that nonprofit as long as the debt is issued. That's why some of these nonprofits are getting out of this practice, because they don't want those long-term relationships. The long-term relationship is with the Public Financing Authority, with yourself. So you eliminate any of that worry, and you're going to be able to have that the responsibility and the discretion on how you want to do it. When we're looking at issuing debt with, and I'm talking more long-term, especially when we go out with bonds. And as Cameron said, banks are only looking for short-term loans. In fact, their short-term portfolio is drawing up. They aren't as aggressive as they were when we did our two loans a few years ago. They're not aggressively seeking more loans to give to agencies. So it's now going out in the bond market. You're going to say,
Pardon me? I'm just curious as to how many people are, because I mean, I assume the interest on these bonds is pretty low at this point. I'm just curious how much interest there is in these bonds.
Cameron, can you address that? Jeff would like to know how much interest there is in bond, revenue bonds.
Oh, in revenue bonds, Jeff, yes. The market is still, very robust. Really, it's, as you probably know, the international market is kind of on a tear right now. U.S. is definitely the predominant player in the international finance market, and everybody now sees municipal bonds as pretty much, the top dog of safety outside the federal government and some of their, treasuries and other federal, obligations are guaranteed by the U.S. government. So, muni debt has been definitely alive and well and enjoying some of its best days. So, when you talk about revenue bonds, especially with Calaveras County Water District, because your rating has gotten better and better each and every year for the last 10 years, and you're now, if you go out for a rating, you're in a national AA category now, whereas that wasn't the case, 12, 15 years ago. So by being fiscally sound, and prudent, you're going to be able to enjoy the best rates that the United States public markets can offer. So whatever that means on any given day, right now, for example, a 30-year bond issue, AA rated on a national AA, you're yielding less than 3%. You're probably down to 2.75% for 30-year debt. So, it's a wonderful time to be a fiscally prudent government agency.
Chairman, over the years, we've refinanced many things. I can think of Saddle Creek. Over the years, as interest has dropped, our financial staff has always been good about refinancing these bonds, and then for the most part, I believe we've always reduced the term and paid the same or in another effort to save money. Would this avenue give us the opportunity if we have debt that can be refinanced? Would this entity be able to do that refinancing with bonds?
Well, I think, I know that Jeff stays on top of that. I don't know the last time we discussed it, but I know that, from time to time, we put our heads together on things, and it seems like that, you're in a good position right now. Some of your debt is going to expire in the next couple of years, and of course your bank loans that were done over the last few years are still very low interest rates. They're in the low twos.
I'm not asking if there's necessarily an opportunity. I'm just saying, would this entity be the vehicle if that arises?
Absolutely, Jeff. Yeah, this new entity would be the vehicle that would give you the name revenue bond versus COP. That is the key. I think out of all that we talked about here, I just from my perspective, being immersed in the marketplace, it's truly a quarter to a half percent differential. So if what I just said on a 30-year fixed deal is going to, let's just call it 3%, if you were to issue revenue bonds, the same exact transaction, you're going to issue COP, is going to be 325 to 350. And if you quantify that on any given millions of dollars, whether it's for a quarter point for every $4 million, you're talking about $10,000 a year. So right off the bat, if you were to do a $4 million issue, and the first year alone, you're going to save
continuing on with our fiscal responsibility, do we need two motions here or a single motion for both items?
I still have some discussion.
And Brett, if I could just make a comment real quick before we get to that, is it to be clear, the recommendation, what we're asking today in formation of this financing authority is right now it's solely to do for us to gain access to that grant from USDA for Reach 3A. Again, that's bundled. The grant, $1.375 million, is bundled with that loan, and the only entity that will be purchasing anything that we issue from this JPA will be the federal government, USDA, and that's what they require, is to have that kind of security to gain access to the loan, which is required for the grant. We anticipate doing this. We'd love to, you know, again, the idea being we want to maximize grant revenue, so we would like to be able to get access to the same type of funding for the Reach One project, which is in our CFP and will be one of our really important projects going forward. That could be another opportunity, but that would be an opportunity to gain access and to use this financing authority. But again, that would be for the board sitting as that entity to make that decision. But options of other financing, other bond issuances, things like that, that's not anything that we're recommending now. It's simply the other options would be available to this board, to your board sitting as that entity, if you made that formation. But again, we're not advocating for that now. I think one of our real strength is our relatively low debt rate, so taking on any new debt is not something we do lightly. And also, I know on the USDA loan and issuing this bond to get the grant, I think we had even looked at the possibility of prepayment, early payment off of that USDA debt. That again, we're only doing that, this is only being presented right now so that we can get that grant money. So I just want to be clear on that. And it's just, we wanted to bring this to you because instead of doing the same thing of going into a nonprofit corporation, paying a one-time fee, particularly when that business model seems to be disappearing. As we're hearing, the corporations are fewer of them. They don't want to do that kind of transaction. So that's why this is before you today. So,
can I, excuse me, Mr. President, in addressing Director Radman's comments, there's two resolutions that you're going to do, just to clarify. The first resolution is to approve the JPA. The second resolution is to create the Public Financing Authority. Then 2 weeks later, at the next board meeting, that Public Financing Authority will meet for the very first time and go through the loan approval process, or the security approval process.
I think the question was whether we could handle both those together or whether we could do them separately.
Yes.
So we should probably do them separately.
Right. Thank you. In interest of disclosure, Cameron, you and I have talked recently, and my discussion is going to center around that discussion so that we can have this fully vetted. I'm a little disappointed that an effort like a public financing authority would not have come through the finance committee and have us had an opportunity to vet out all of the necessary details of whether or not it's viable for us. I feel as though we're in kind of a knee-jerk reaction to the need to access the money through USDA. So in taking the time, as you know, I looked at the ICFA and their member agent cities, and did some research on those folks, and what exactly came out of it was what the Los Angeles Times is very clear in stating, that this is not a stellar group to be associated with, that they can't seem to manage their finances very well. But I look at the agreement, the resolution here we have in front of us, it says, associate members, including making loans to tax-exempt organizations from the proceeds of mortgage revenue bonds to finance the acquisition of multifamily residential housing, including mobile home parks, under the provision of Chapter 8, Part 5, Division 31. That really, this group is all about issuing bonds and sales in the future, and it's primarily to support housing goals, because that's what it says right in about us on their website, is their purpose is issuing bonds. Now, in my world, what we're doing here is we're in essence going to try to circumvent Prop 218 and putting this before the voters when we decide to issue bonds in the future. And I'm not against the idea of bonding projects in a longer term. That's not the point. The point is that We have other venues or vehicles that we could use, and since this is a USDA loan, you remember I asked, should we be going to our local USDA office in Jackson and talking to them to secure help for an administrator? And why can't they be, like an RCD, be used as an administrator for these funds? Because they do that on a regular basis. So, that being said, I really am concerned about this and its relationship to how we're getting around Prop 218 and having an opportunity to have the people of this district vote on the indebtedness.
How does the 218, because that's rate related. I'm curious, how's that related to the issuing of debt?
Cameron,
unless we raise rates.
Yeah, Cameron, do you want to speak to that?
Yeah, to the 218, in a vacuum, it does not change whether the board issues the bonds or whether a new public financing authority issues the bonds. The underlying security of the transaction is the same. It's identically the same whether the district does it or whether a public financing authority does it. And there's really, there's no attempt to circumvent the laws anyway. This is actually, as I said, it's only a tool to call the issue a revenue bond versus a COP. There's nothing more to it than that. I just don't want there to be a misperception that that I could ever recommend anything that was to circumvent any constitutional or good of the people whatsoever. That's just not the case here. So
I want to read what you stated to me, though, is that the government needed a vehicle without being challenged by taxpayers groups, and that Prop 218 takes away revenues for other than operational funding.
Wait, I said that? I'm sorry.
Yes. I wrote
it down. I'm sorry.
It says, government needed a vehicle without being challenged by taxpayer groups, and that Prop 218 takes away revenues for other than operations. I wrote it as you said it, sir.
Okay. Well, I don't know, where I said that, but I can tell you that 218, what 218 does is it limits the ability to raise rates unless you have a direct nexus to the reason for the rate increase. What 218 does is I think what we were talking about is there's watchdog, there's taxpayer groups, there's watchdog groups that are constantly challenging 218 out there. And the most recent one, of course, I'm sure you're aware of, is the San Juan Capistrano case, where the city of San Juan Capistrano had a rate ordinance that was adopted that had a tiered rate structure, and the court found that you can't have these tiered rate structures unless you can justify the increased cost per tier and substantiate pretty much in an engineer's report that substantiates those findings so that you have a legal rate adoption. And so when it comes to the Joint Powers Authority, it has nothing to do with that, because the district still has the ability to issue COPs under and that's the traditional way that a government agency other than a city, well, even cities do it with their general fund, but as far as water agencies, sanitation districts, public utility districts, if they don't have a revenue bond, the ability to issue revenue bonds, they have to do a certificate of participation issue. But the underlying credit of the transaction, the security, the rates that are pledged to the refinancing, those are all protected under 218. And I was just referring to the watchdog groups that are out there right now, really keeping an eye on 218, but not on the public financing authority side. It wouldn't be any different than the district doing an issue.
Cameron, I do understand the COP situation, because this goes back into the 70s for Calaveras County Water District. But my concern is that I would like to see this come back to the Finance Committee and have us have a good, thorough discussion on the formation of this type of an entity before we just throw it up before the full board. I just see this as we need to get the money, so we're going to do it this way, and it has a long-term effect. This is not something that's going to, not go forward. It goes on for quite some time, and I don't know as I want to be, as I said before, joined at the hip to ICFA because of their background.
Well,
Director Mills, if I could just, President Sherman, just jump in real quick on that. Please don't think that we're saying that you have to make a decision today on this. If the board would so like to take this back to the Finance Committee and come with a recommendation at the next board meeting, we can do that. We're looking at getting all of this in place so we can move forward with construction in a timely manner. But certainly, and I just want to be clear on the rates side of it, this, you know, and I'm not wedded to, you know, to this approach. We could consider, you know, all of the approaches, but this really is all about us getting access to grants, which keep rates down. If we don't have access to funding like USDA funding, then we are stuck having to foot the entire bill of these projects. And so that's the underlying goal. And but again, whatever is the board's direction on this, we'll go that way.
In a larger sense, and this is probably going to speak to what you won't let us look at right now, is that I would like to see our projects amortized over 20, 30, 40 years and to be able to bond them or to finance them over that longer period. We're in a cash crunch simply because we're trying to do everything in these very tight cycles. And yet the projects themselves are longer term pieces of our world. So I don't have a problem with that. What I have a problem with is just bringing this up in this manner and not having us have a chance to bring it through the committee process as we've done with almost everything else and be able to fully discuss it and be sure that that is what we want as a solution.
Point well taken.
I just want to make sure that whatever there is, whatever information we have on this particular JPA is readily accessible to all the members of the Finance Committee and to the board also, because you need to know. I mean, we act as a body.
Thank you.
Good. Jeff?
Well, my point is, I think many times, the full board is just as qualified to vet this as the Finance Committee. You know, I think that, you know, many times that, the full board doesn't get to hear some of the details because too much work is done in committee. So I'm not a real big fan of having everything go through committee, because I don't believe anybody's more qualified to sit on the committee than anybody else. But I think that all we're being asked to do today is to add another financing vehicle to our ability. If we adopt this, we do not have to use it in the future. Am I correct with that? We can still go get a COP. We can do some of those long-term financing. This, I believe, actually gives us the ability to have that long-term financing ability at a lower cost. But we don't have to choose it in the future. It can sit on the shelf forever and never be used again. You know, it can be used on this one-time thing. So, I mean, I don't have an issue with this at all. I think I see it for what it is. I don't think it has a darn thing to do with Prop 218, because we're not raising rates. 218 is rate related, so I really don't have a problem with it. I also don't have a problem with going back to the committee. I think it's been vetted pretty well here today, and I think it was helpful to have all five board members be able to ask all these upfront questions as opposed to getting a report from two of our peers. I'm content with moving this thing forward, but either way, I just don't think it's it is not the boogeyman to me. I think it's another public financing opportunity, and it will allow us to take advantage, if we so desire, on the bond market, which I believe that we should be looking into some longer-term bonds when necessary. You know, certainly, right now, we've got the debt we have is very, very low interest rate, so I don't know if it's going to be all that advantage, that much advantage just now, but I see that, more need for it in the future. I think that this is another, it would be a good vehicle for us to have to, if we just decide to take on any long-term bond debt.
Correct, Brad. I have a few questions that I'd like to ask, including this one-time cost and zero regardless of the number of transactions over the lifetime of this agreement. I.e., if we have 200 transactions versus one transaction, doesn't matter, we pay the $15,000, that's it. Is that correct?
That's correct.
Okay. What is the role then, or the participation of this ICFA group in relationship to us and our meetings and how we handle our own, you know, specific projects and all? What can we expect from them?
You know, there really is nothing that I am aware of in the future. Once you form this new Joint Powers Authority, it stands on its own. Your board would be the board. You have to, of course, keep it operational. There's a few administrative tasks. And for instance, if you, you know, as board members change, as a board of director, that new board member, when it takes a seat, of course, becomes automatically under the Joint Powers Agreement, becomes the board member of the authority. But there is a roster of public officials that needs to be updated with the state of California. So there's a few things you have to do. Your staff has to keep it operational, but as far as any association with ICFA, it would terminate at the time of the agreement. They basically just set the background forever.
Okay, and President Strange, the only reason we recommended ICFA as opposed to, I believe it's the communities, statewide communities financing authority, was based on the cost. Sure. The cost to join that one, I believe, was $7,000 more.
$5,000 more.
So, I mean, but that option is available. If the board has concerns over certain members of the ICFA, I mean, again, if there's comfort here going back and coming back with this with a refined, we have an opportunity. I don't want you to feel like we didn't expect that might happen. And again, that's we can do that.
Yeah, no worries. I have a few more questions. The focus of this JPA then, we're going to limit it to only CCWD projects, right? I mean, we're not going to have NGOs come to us and then, you know, ask us to help fund or manage a grant that they got. And at the same time, I want to make sure that we don't compete, or that this JPA doesn't compete for grants and management of the grants against a potentially newly formed Calaveras RCD or any of those. I think that's one of my reluctance, is that, you know, we get a really nice sweetheart deal. And I understand the financing and all, but I think, you know, the RCDs and some of those entities, the NGOs or nonprofits, they have a place too, and they live off of the admin fees to grants and all. And so I wouldn't, you know, I'd be very reluctant to compete, so to speak, either perceived or real, with some, especially this potential newly formed RCD, you know, in the county. At the same time, my goal is to limit and reduce cost to the district.
Yeah. President Strange, thank you for bringing that up. I want to be clear. This is not to compete with any other entity in the county, or to preclude anybody else from going after financing for their project. It's just very specifically targeted to issue the securities to be able to obtain the financing when our district is going for grants and it has associated loans, or if we have other loans that we want to, or debt that we want to issue for specifically to do our projects. You know, I'm a huge believer in our partnering with other agencies and using that as much as absolutely possible. But again, if there were any conceivable way that this would hurt us in our ability to partner with others, this recommendation would be before you. I don't see any way that it does.
Well, I appreciate that, David. And last comment was, I'm more inclined to ask that this be brought to the Finance Committee first and have them look at it, but I also very much appreciate and agree with Director Davidson, and that it's nice to bring it to a full board at this level to have this kind of discussion too, that we would not have had it gone to the Finance Committee, or at least I don't think so.
It's been very helpful.
Beginning.
Very
so,
helpful.
Yeah, back to your comment right now about the RCD, if there was a competition, any other entity would have to join the ICFA before they could do that. I mean, they wouldn't piggyback on us, right?
Well, that would be for the, if they obtained similar funding through USDA for their own projects, then they would have the options available to them just like we do to us.
Right.
If we ever had a joint venture type project where we were partnering on, say, a hydro development project, and we wanted to jointly finance it, then that would be, you know, we would find the right vehicle to do that. You know, but again, I don't see any way that this precludes that.
This is just, okay. This is financing the share of the grants, not competing.
Well, I just have a question for Director Mills. What in partnering with ICFA, and it seems to be your reluctance to do that based on their reputation, what you know about, what danger, what do you see as, or how does that become an obstacle?
Well, how it does is that you're always known to the company you keep. And I look at the group and the amount of writing in the Los Angeles Times on each time of each individual city that is a full member of the ICFA kind of leads me to think, do we want to, even in the future, be associated? I mean, if somebody actually wants to do their homework on this group, or those people that are the actual members of the group, I don't want to be associated with them. And that's part of the issue. I'd rather us take the need to administer this grant loan combination and take care of it in whatever way we can for now, and give us time to fully vet out the thought of an authority and how that authority could be best used in the future to serve the needs that we have, and not leave this as a reaction to the need to take care of that grant loan. That's the whole point.
Can I ask Cameron a question, please, then? Cameron, any debt that we take on, will we be associated with any of these other members, or will they solely look at our entity in relation to issuing a bond?
Well, yeah, if you're asking for a legal answer here, the answer is yes. There's no legal association. There's clearly, the liability cuts off in terms of the legal covenants and the joint powers agreement. But, politically speaking, I did call Standard Forest because I wanted to find out the answer as far as a credit perception, because we deal with these kinds of things, of course, all the time. And I think CCWD yourself has dealt with it with your assessment district issue on 604 and whether negative marks from another situation can create a black eye or negative mark for the district. And Standard Forest would be the thing that know that if anything happens, whether it be CSEDA, I asked generically, I didn't go into specifics, I just asked generically, would the counterparties with my power agreement have an effect on the creditworthiness if something were to go wrong? And their answer was no, because they have the skills and sophistication to understand the underpinnings of the agreement. So, take that for what it's worth. I mean, I can't speak to the rest of the political scenario, because there may be, who knows, some written stuff in the LA Times that you need to, somebody might have some perception about. So yes, but legally speaking, the answer is no. There's no legal connection.
Okay. Then my question is, will one finance committee meeting be enough time to vet the ICFA?
Yes.
Yes, it would. Okay, well, as I say, I want to make sure that I have all the information that I need, or if I have to go somewhere, tell me where to go. Well, no, not exactly.
The question for staff is will delaying this, or by delaying this decision, when will we be able to bring it back, and will that cause the timing?
Right,
that's a good question that I had to. Dave, can you address that? The timing of
yeah, and I think what we would do is we use the next finance committee meeting, which for some reason was not scheduled at its normal date on the 15th, but instead on the 22nd. And I would ask, that's something we're talking about later, to try to keep that. If we could go back to the 15th, would be ideal. That would give us more time then to prepare for the board meeting after it. Otherwise, we're not going to be able to incorporate the outcome of that into the agenda materials.
I think we can make an adjustment.
Great. Okay. So then my, Jeff, unless you have any other insight, I would, we should be able to come back, and then I don't want to put the board in a position of having to, make a decision it's uncomfortable with. This is, part of the thought process on this was we had the 23rd meeting to be able to come back to you and get, we've got options, and it really is up to the board. And I really do appreciate the dialogue. I mean, that's, to me, this is how this. It's an important decision like this really should be made, so thank you.
Well, go ahead. May I add to that?
Mm-hmm.
The process would be, if we brought it back on the 15th, we would then to the Finance Committee, and I want to come back to that for clarification on what you want to be done at the Finance Committee, what the expectation is for the information. Then you would come back to your board on the 23rd, and you so desire, approve this package. Then you would come back on April 9th, which would then be the first meeting of the Public Financing Authority, which is then the first time you would be able to address the USDA loan. So the only thing that's hooked up in this process is you cannot award, and this is for full disclosure, you cannot award the construction bid on the USDA Reach 3A project until the loan is formalized. So that's just, I just wanted you to understand it. So the first opportunity you would have to be able to award the Reach 3A construction project would be April 9th, or the first meeting.
The 13th.
April 13th, and does that create, or what types of challenges?
No, the bid would still be, Charles, per our specs, their bid is, stays open for us to consider accepting for a certain period of time. That would still be, my understanding, within that period.
We have 90 days, so okay, I think so we get the last meeting where the contract is not in jeopardy would be the last meeting in April.
Okay, so there's enough time, and again, they're not even going to be mobilizing for construction until we get out of the wet season, best case in May. We would like to go ahead and award the contract, because one of the things we said we want to do is to meet the public with the contractor up in the community, and so they understand who's going to be doing the work and how they're going to do it, and then that contractor gets a sense of how important that is for us, and they're accountable to the public. So. I think that's why we can make that happen within the schedule.
One of the things that was just Mona just mentioned, there is some paperwork we have to file with the state once this JPA and PFA is approved, and we want to make sure that there may be some delay in the state receiving it and filing it. So I need to find out how long that would take as to when everything is there to be able to come back if we can on the 13th. To approve the contract, to approve the award of the contract. So it may have to be pushed out, but that's something I can find out. I do want to come back to what is your expectation of the results of this going back to the Finance Committee so that when we do come back in 2 weeks, we are able to present you with the information as to what do you want to see. Is it just a review, or is there more information that you want to be provided to you?
And my hope is that information would be vetted or vetted during discussions at the hopefully the next fiscal or financial committee meeting, which would be moved from the 23rd or whatever to the 15th.
Also, our expectation is to look at what other options are available, if there are other tools or things we can use.
Now we're starting to get a little bit, because if you say we're going to vet the NCFA, and okay. It's going to take us a lot of time to do that, because you're going to be, I don't know what you're going to be supplying us with,
right.
Okay? So that okay. If we...
We can let it. Okay.
Yeah, we need to.
Sure. Yeah, maybe I can.
Can I just jump in here? I apologize. Okay. I know that Director Mills has some concerns with ICFA. We do have the option of using CSCDA, and that is an option. It would be $5,000 more. It's a little bit more time-wise, but that is an option available to you. And if you choose to substitute CSCDA in ICFA's position today, I have vetted this out with our council, and that is an option. We do have those agreements ready. If you feel more comfortable with CSCDA, we do have that option. Or you can take it back to the Finance Committee and let them view it and say what is their two preferences, either ICFA or CSCDA.
If I'm understanding this correctly, we can use this forever, we can use it once, single time.
Correct. For the life of the debt.
Right.
Yes.
So if for some reason, and I also understood from what Cameron said that we're going to be judged independently on any bonds that we put out there. That we're not going to be associated with any of the cities that may have been talked about in the LA Times. So for me, I mean, I really don't care which one it is. I mean, if it's $5,000 more, I mean, we're, this is still very, very low upfront cost for any sort of long-term debt. So, I mean, I'm content with going with the people we have on this one if time really becomes an issue. But if, I mean, I really just want them to, if they're going to do anything at all, is to just vet these two agencies out and come back with a recommendation. But I would prefer to have both agreements in front of us so the board can make a decision one way or the other.
Certainly.
Yes. And Director Davis, and President Strach, I think I would be most comfortable going through the committee and coming back to the board. And what I would like to look at, let's look at the three options that are available to us, ICFA, the Statewide Communities Financing Authority, or to do the same thing that we've done in the past and try to hire a corporation to do this. But the question there would be, and Cameron will need some guidance from you, what are options are even available to us now, knowing that that's a disappearing option for us, for agencies like us, and what would be the time requirements on that. But I think that would be what I would say, let's evaluate that and get a recommendation from the Finance Committee to the board, and then that would be what we present and ask the board to take option on in this next meeting.
Okay, so I'm going to go ahead right now and recommend that we table this discussion, we take it off the, take it away from discussion, that we bring it to, first of all, we change the Financial Committee meeting from the 23rd to the 15th.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, and that this be brought to this issue in both resolutions, discussion be vetted through that committee and then brought to our very next board meeting for adoption.
Before we, I have one question. CSCDA, yes. Is that part of CSDA?
No.
No.
Okay.
So
similar alphabet.
If we pull a motion like that, is there a need for public comment?
Well, we have a table.
We should have a motion to have public comment. Yeah, I think it's a good idea. Yeah,
we can do so.
Yeah, we've had a lot of discussion. I think that and we may have members of the public who want to contribute to the dialogue. I think it's helpful.
So did we have a motion on that or?
No, I still have one. I want to make something clear. If I want both vehicles brought back at the next meeting, it's great to have the Finance Committee make a recommendation, but with the board, the full board may not go with their recommendation. So I'd like to have both entities, resolutions to be prepared so we can choose between the two.
Right.
So to make sure that we get something done.
There, yes, and in answer to that, we already have those prepared.
Okay, perfect.
Yes.
Yeah. And there's actually three.
Well, right, I don't think we're
in. Okay, that's the other one. Okay, yeah, sure. The other thing I wanted to point out or ask is Cameron available for the meeting on the available questions on the meeting on the 15th, as well as our next board meeting?
Yes, okay. I can make myself available on the 15th, yes.
Thank you. Okay, I'll second the motion to table.
Okay, so we've got a motion to table. So go ahead, Maura. Director Nelson.
Oh, thank you.
I recommended that there's a motion.
Oh,
I guess I recommended it, so that in essence, that's a motion. Okay. Yes, I'm sorry. Seconded by Director Radiman. Public comment?
Well, we're doing these things wrong, but I'm trying to public comment. But if you have a motion to second the table, you should have public comment. I mean, the whole point of the tabling is to stop discussion, but I have no problem with
it. We just talked about it earlier, Jeff, and that's why
I don't have any problem, but
okay.
We just got to do it around the other.
Thank you.
Sure.
I'm glad the Prop 218 issue was brought up. The race code of Prop 218. And I would like to see if you assume a substantial amount of checkbook, open checkbook, on the heart where and how it's going to distribute the liability of any impact also. Is it going to come out of property taxes? Is it going to come out of the ratepayers? I think that should be made clear. And so I'm glad you're tabling it, I'm glad you're thinking about it, and I will help you publicize that so people will know about it.
actually what they're getting into by their elected officials. So, thank you for tabling it. And thinking about it.
Thank you. Any other public comment? Seeing none, we'll bring it back to the board for vote.
So go ahead, Jeff.
What are the experts? All those in favor?
Parliamentary.
Are all those in favor of it?
Aye.
Aye. Okay, all those against? Nay. None. Done. Table. Thank you. Let's take a break.
How much coffee?
10 minute break.